95. This is their last chance you have to be in church in 2016. And by the time you come Sunday, it's a whole brand new year. So let's stand together to sing it. 195, down at the cross where my Savior died. Let's sing it together. Brother Bob will lead us.
Down at the cross where my Savior died, down where for cleansing from sin I cried, there to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to His name, glory to His name, glory to His name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to His name. On that third, the precious fountain that saves from sin, I am so glad. Jesus saves me and keeps me clean. Glory to His name. Glory to His name. Glory to His name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to His name. Come to this fountain so rich and sweet. Cast thy poor soul at the Savior's feet. Plunge into day and be made complete. Glory to His name. Glory to His name. Glory to His name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to His name.
Good singing, and good to see you in church tonight. Looking forward to a good service. We have Brother John Combest and Emily, and looking forward to having, they're going to sing tonight, by the way, and Brother John's going to preach for us, but he's also going to show us some pictures of what they've been doing for the last 9 months or so, other than having a baby, I guess, and though that surely is part of the 9 months, amen? And they were in Uganda, and they're going to be headed eventually to the Congo. And he's going to say a little bit what the Lord has taught them, and some we'll get to see a little bit what they did there in Uganda. And he's got some of those pictures together for us, and appreciate him doing that. And looking forward to a great time together tonight. Thanks for being here. Let's start with prayer, shall we? Father, we bow before you in prayer. We thank you, Lord, for another opportunity that's ours to gather together here. Thank you, Lord, for each one who's made the effort to be here this evening. And Lord, we do pray for those who are not feeling well tonight, and a lot of sickness going around, and I pray that you put your healing hand upon folks and raise them up, Lord, they'll be able to be with us on the Lord's Day on Sunday. But Father, we bow before you here at the beginning of the service, and we commit the service into your hands, and we pray that you'll use it in each one of our lives. Be with John and Emily as they sing. Be with Brother John as he updates us on the work you've done through them and in them in these last 9 months, and what, Lord, we anticipate you doing in the future, if you tarry your coming. And so, Lord, control the service and make it exactly what you'd want it to be. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, you may be seated. Brother John, you come right on up. You don't sit down. We're going to let you come right now, and you do the slide portion now if you would like, and then we'll come back and have you preach later, okay? Brother John.
All right, good evening to you. And it is good to be back. Some of y'all already commented, wow, John, you dressed up. I was like, well, this is the first week I had my suit coats back, so this is the first week I get to dress up. But so just real quick, we want to run through you the year of what we've been doing in Uganda and why we went to Uganda instead of Congo for the year and just some of the background behind it. But I hope you enjoy it. And if you get the newsletter of November, that also kind of briefs you through the year also of us. But real quick, I'm going to use a laser to help point out some things. This was the month before we left the USA. And so the next picture, go ahead, the next picture here, this is when we arrived. So we arrived February 2nd in Uganda, and February is the hottest season of their year. And so it's over 100 every day. At night, it gets down into the mid-80s. And so that is your temperature range right there. And it's really high humidity most of the time. So It was quite the change for our bodies just in that quick time span there. Go ahead, the next picture here. So this is the property we went to work with in northern Uganda, and I kind of put two pictures together here. It cuts out a lot of property on the sides, and it cuts out half our property on the bottom. So this is just literally a small portion. But this is our compound here. Now this is a little older picture that I took in 2014 when I went. But we now have a concrete wall all the way around our property because of some security issues. And then over here is the compound that was built originally for dormitories for college. It's now being used for the dormitories for the translation team and all their families. Most of their families live right in here. This is our church building. It looks small and is a little smaller, but it's still a good size. All in here is our outbuildings for three of our workers on the property, full-time workers, and also our kitchen. This ministry is a lot bigger than a normal small missionary compound. So we were there to work with Sam Moss and his family. They've been there about 3 years now and took over for another missionary that had been there about 12 years in all. So that's who we were working with. Next one here. So this is a picture. If I'm standing on our water tower, we have to pump all water. We have an underground spring, so we don't have to filter and purify all our water. We pump it up to a water tower. So standing on top of our water tower, you're looking now towards here's like the kitchen and housing area, but here's the dormitory for our translation team workers, and the church is behind it there. Let me turn that on. I'm loud enough, people say. Okay, next picture here. So this is looking down another angle off the water tower. These are two of our outbuildings. Both of them are lived in by translation families. And do pray, the translation families have moved from their tribe in Mahdi land to our tribe, in Lukbar land, and they don't mix. And so already a lot of issues have come up with some, you wouldn't call it persecution, but threats and a lot of things like that going on because they're just from a different tribe. And that is especially with Brother Dominic living out on the far extreme of our property there. Next picture here. So this is looking out the backside. You can't really see it here. We live on top of a hill. We're right at the foothills of the mountains that go into Congo. And so we live in the foothills here, and we're on a top of a mountain, you might say, and looking down in a valley. And this hill across here, if you were to walk straight across, it'd take you 45 minutes to an hour to get across. And you can also ride your bike around, and that takes you about the same time. Next picture here. So this is looking down our valley, and this empties out into a huge plateau area down farther into Uganda. One of the things with this is we have a lot of folks, and you'll hear a little bit about it in just a second, but just down this valley is a village called Omo, and we held a preaching point there every week. But the problem is these people walk up an extremely steep hill the whole way from their village all the way to our church. And a lot of, if they're even older adults, just can't make the walk. It's too far for them. And you hear stories about these people walk 2 days, you know, to get to church. Well, these folks walk most of their morning to get to church if they're older. So really, as you're looking into this picture, each hilltop here could use their own church. Because a lot of the older people in those villages, they just can't get out. And I'm not talking old people. The average lifespan is about 50 years. And so you're not talking old in our mindset. And so, but a lot of them just can't go that far or can't go that high up these hills to get to church. And so really, a lot of these places could use churches. The sad thing is, from the capital city all the way up to where we worked, it's about an 8-hour drive. It used to be about a 12-hour drive. It's the whole way across the country. And there's not one Baptist church along that whole stretch for that whole drive. And we are the only one in our region, other than some national Baptist churches in our region. But we're the only other one. So it's kind of out there a little ways. From our area, if you were to walk to another good, solid church, it'd be a couple days walk for you to get to another good church. And so just kind of give you the mindset of the area. Next picture here. So this is where we're eventually going. It's the small country here. It's called Republic of Congo. The center one here is what people know a lot about. It's called the DRC, also called Congo. But we crossed over that, and we spent the year in northern Uganda in a region called Arua. And that's where we were for the year. Go ahead, next slide here. So this is the whole purpose, really, for going here in Uganda, was the translation work. Next picture here. In 2014, I went with a team to Uganda. Actually, you might recognize Brother Fielder's here, Brother James Overton's here, a couple other men with the team. Went to help start a training program for these men. These men had already been in training for the translation work for 2 years, but this was actually the finalizing of the training where they could actually get hands-on of what are we going to be doing. So I was there for that group, next picture here, and these are the five men that eventually came out of that to actually start the translation. We have here Brother Tom. All these men are pastors, and a couple of them have started multiple churches. We have Brother Tom on the side here. We have Brother Robert in the middle, and I have something about him in our November update if you read that. Brother Dominic here is probably one of the most highly trained men in the group and has a master's degree through university and also in biblical studies. A very, very smart man, and also the lead for our translation team. He's the one that any questions come in about the translation, he's the one that has to answer those questions. And definitely led of God and a very, very wise man. Brother David here, he was the one that years ago, I think I told about him before we left, he had been a Catholic priest and was trying to convince a man to come back to the Catholic Church, and the man led him to the Lord. And in turn, he is super zealous for the Lord. He has started a couple churches already, even within the last couple years, and has already started several other preaching points that will eventually become churches. And so just an amazing man. And then Brother Marcello here, he's one I also spoke of before he left. He was the one that before he had been saved, he had been a drunk and a very heavy drunk and had been poisoned several times, being people seeking to kill him. Well, then after he got saved, he began preaching for the Lord and got poisoned again. And so he is often really sick. You never know if he's going to show up for the work in the morning just because he's always sick, dealing with just the after effects of all the poisoning. But also it doesn't help, he's older now, and that's starting to catch up with him as well. Next picture here. So this is when we arrived in February, my project for the next couple months was getting the translation room ready. This was just a room that was roughed out, concrete, and so we painted it in, we put solar in. That's what we use solar a lot in Africa, because the sun's always a guarantee over there, it seems like. And this is Brother Henry here. You've heard about him in the Henry letters and also in some of my newsletters. But we're putting up some solar. We also put a papyrus roof inside, a ceiling inside the translation room to really keep a lot of the heat out. Just everything we could to make it comfortable for the translators so they could work. They work a good 8-9 hours a day on this project with only about an hour and a half for lunch. And so it's a place that needs to be comfortable that they can truly work in that long and keep their mind steady and going. Next picture here. Here we're going through, once we arrived, we started classes again, leading them up to the project. It had been a few months since they had been on the property and been going through classes. So we did Greek, we did some other classes, trying to get them running up, getting ready for the translation. Next picture here. In April, Brother Fielder came over for the actual start of the project. We had over 30 Mahdi pastors come in. And a lot of these pastors would not exactly align themselves with our stripe of Baptists. But the thing with them is they're still preaching the gospel. The only problem is they don't have a good Bible. All they have is a New Testament, and it's really messed up. I mean, strongly messed up. Huge portions are missing out of it. And so getting these men in not only gave us a chance to say, hey, here's a project to give you the Word of God, but it also allowed us to do some training on, now this is what your Bible says, but truly the Bible does not say that. It's been completely turned around. And really excellent results. Each one of these men have now set up a schedule where each month one of the translators return to Mahdi land and they visit one of these churches. And they're taking a circuit and they'll do it for as many years as the project takes. And what it does is it keeps the churches updated and it gets them excited about, look, you know, we're getting closer to having the Word of God. We're getting closer to having the Word of God. And so it's really been exciting. Next slide here. Some of the work going on, this would have been in May that we were really getting started. You'll see they do a lot of it by hand initially. The reason for this, initially we were considering going computer, but the problem is a lot of these men don't have a lot of skills in computer. So it would then take time to teach them how to run a computer. So what we do is we do everything on paper, and then two of them are super highly skilled men, one an engineer for the government, the other through the universities, and they are the ones that deal with the computer work of everything. And so it works out really smoothly and really well. Next picture here. This is them at the board. So what they'll initially do is they'll translate everything on paper, and then they'll bring all that together into the book or the paragraph they're working on, and then all that goes on the board one by one. And any issues, then they'll look at it as a whole group. And any issues that arise, it's all done by markers so they can erase it and just kind of put in until they're satisfied with what they have come to. Next slide here. So that was all up to May and up to June. In June, we had a group come over to start the Gospel Power Baptist Church. The pastor of this work was trained in the college for quite a few years and was actually ordained at that big dedication meeting for the project. And so in June, we had a group come over to start the project. Go ahead, the next slide here. We started their building, and again, if you kept up with our updates, you saw a lot of this throughout the updates. Next picture. We also did a kids' class every single day, and usually two or three times a day even, kids' classes were being done, as well as many times we'd go throughout the village. And a village isn't just a little group of huts. It's a widespread area with a ton of groups of huts. It's all just one family group. And so we would go within that village and hold meetings all throughout the village. Next picture. And then every evening, everyone would come together for the main central meeting. And the theme of the meetings was basically on sin and of righteousness, judgment, and salvation. That's basically what we covered, all evangelistic, for that week. Next picture here. So when I returned, would have been at the end of September, this is the stage they were at. They were just beginning to raise the timbers at the end of September. And so, praise the Lord, we were able to actually take part in seeing it completely finished by the end of October. We were able to actually get in and put the iron sheets on the roof. And that's all that will be done for a couple years until the people make enough bricks to raise the walls. Next picture here. This is right before, literally a week or two before we left Uganda. We went over to Edjapala's where the church plant was done and got to meet with Pastor Morris is here and his wife and their little boy. And then one of their little girls is here. One of them is running behind me there. You can kind of see her skirt. But he has three girls and one little boy. But he's the pastor of the work, and now they have quite a few folks beginning to come faithfully. I don't know if you remember the story we told in one of the newsletters. I was kind of restricted. I didn't want to share too much because it's not completely my ministry. It's another man's. But one of the stories that came out of this was two ladies were saved, and I could tell the story of the week that we were there for the meetings. There was a lot of resistance that week. But their husband, after they got saved and began coming faithfully, they disappeared, and they got sent away. And who knows where they went. Usually men like that will send them off to Congo. He was a Muslim man and one of the few in their village. But you'll just never see him again. But this is the type of place you work in. A lot of these places, if it's resistance, well, you're going to see it come out very strongly in some different ways. But he does have a good, strong group. This is just a few of them. We arrived after the service had finished. And it was a really cold and rainy day. That's why little Lydia here is all bundled up, and I'm wearing my jacket. And cold and rainy means it was in the low 70s and rainy. So next picture here. So this is our church, Victory in Christ Independent Baptist Church, and you can see part of our building in the background there. Now, eventually, the outside of the bricks here will be plastered, and so it'll be a nice, flat, plastered building, almost exactly like a wall would be. But for now, we don't have the money to finish it out. The people are slowly getting that together. Next picture here. So this is our Easter Sunday, literally just a few weeks after we got there. We hold three main services a year. It would be Easter, their holiday, which is their Independence Day, and then Christmas. And every year, we'll pack out the building with folks. We'll usually serve a meat dish along with the cassava and everything else, the bean dishes, because meat they only usually get once a year at Christmas. And so serving meat really allows the members of our church to invite their families to say, just come, you know, we're going to have meat. And that really brings them in. So, but along with this, really, it's good to see our folks because they're not a lot in number, but they're very, very strong. They're very, very strong in their faith. And it's really good to see them work among their own families, which is really hard to do in Africa because being a saved Christian is a whole different thing from what the village is used to. Next picture here. So this is some of the ladies. These ladies will work. This is that Easter Sunday and the food. They'll work from even before dawn in the morning getting this food ready. The beans will take many, many, many hours to cook, and they cook everything over open fires, over stones. Everybody does that, and over sometimes some charcoal. But these ladies have worked all morning just for this right here, and they'll usually be gone in like 20 minutes. And so it's a long day's work. Next picture here. Usually on our special days, we also do it on some other days, but usually we save the baptisms for special days. Because what you'll find over there is many times the Anglicans or the Catholics, as long as you have money, you can be baptized. You know, you pay them, they'll baptize you. You know, you come in, give them some money, you hit the water. But we want to make it something special. And that's why we have reserved it for special days. Some people disagree, and that's fine. But we want to make it known. Look, this isn't just something you pay money and get to do. It doesn't take any money. It takes faith in God. And it's a very special occasion. So you'll find many people that won't even come to the special services and won't even eat the special food. But when the baptism's going on, they come around just to see what's going on. And so it makes it really special. So throughout the year, I don't know even how many people we've got to see baptized throughout the year. Many of them folks have been coming for a long time that just finally got saved, got it settled, and got baptized. It was real exciting to see. Next picture here. So this is our preaching point in Omo. This hill right here, if you were to go all the way up, it's super steep, and it goes very, very high. It goes down to our property. And this is where all the folks from Omo come. They walk up, not this hill, but another hill, and go up to our church. We held the preaching point here every Friday. And many times, especially before me and Emily went to Kampala for the baby, we would pack out this building every single week. And we were looking to actually form it into a church. Well, then once we had returned, our lead man for this ministry had left, and it was almost nothing again. And so we now have another man that's taken over the ministry. And by the time I left, we were beginning to go every week again, and we were starting to see another 5-10 adults every single week again. So do pray for this work. I can't explain the whole history behind it, but they've had 2 or 3 different tragedies with their lead men that have really devastated the area spiritually towards the gospel. So really pray for this work. But this is one of the buildings, and Brother Patrick is here in the white shirt. He's one of the main men in our church that has shown himself really strong. Next picture here. This is Brother Henry here speaking in the Omo church. We would take every other week when we went. I would preach 1 week, he would preach the other. And on the weeks that he would preach, he would say nothing in English. And that would help me kind of pick up and kind of learn a little bit more about how they speak or how they act because I could just watch. And I wasn't the one talking and being translated into their language. So I really enjoyed the preaching point a lot, and it really helped me tremendously. Next slide here. So this is another one of the preaching points. And we had actually entered this in 2014, got back into it again this year when Brother David came back for the translation. And absolutely love this area. This is the area, I don't know if you remember, in 2015 when we were showing the slides, the kids would all jump in the back of the truck and just pack the whole back of the truck out. Well, this is that preaching point. And we just started it back up. Now that I returned, Brother David was there to actually get it started again. Next picture here. This is us. Again, one of the most favorite things about getting back into the villages is you can just be with the people. You're not on a rush of time. You're not on a rush of schedule. They are there just to see and talk with you. And so just being able to sit with the people, sit with their families, even eat their food, and just spend time with them was real special. And that's one of the reasons I enjoy the preaching point so much, because you weren't in a rigid church building. You were just among them. And you could really spend some time with them. And it was real special. That's one of the things I miss most about Uganda, is just spending time with the people. Next picture here. So really, our biggest goal, our biggest focus was just making an impact. And the children here, this is at Brother Merce's church in Ejipala. And some of these are his girls. This one here and probably this one here. And this one here also, I guess, is. But this is some of his girls. But the last one here, last picture here. This is a lady from Omo and one of Brother Morse's little girls. But really, when it comes down to it, what was our year in Uganda? It was a year of learning for us. But most of all, truly, it was a year of just being in help and in aid, whatever we could do, and trying to glorify God through it all. So many people, it was kind of interesting, and you see the difference in people and culture when you go to a different country. And you see it usually pretty quickly if you actually live in the culture. But the same thing across the world is people. And many times, they'll act the same. Many times, they'll respond even in the same ways. Many times, they're just people. And they have the same heart anybody else does. And so whether we're in Uganda or in the future Congo, it'll be the same response. It'll be the same goal. Glorify God and reach people. Make an impact where we can. And I thank y'all. It's really been a blessing to be in Uganda. One of the reasons for Uganda over Congo was there's no Baptist missionary in Congo right now. In fact, there hasn't been for almost 20 years. And so when I began to search into it, I found 3 other missionaries had tried. All 3 of them had turned around and left. And so I felt it wise, and so did my pastor, which is my dad, thought it wise, why don't you go somewhere else where there is a missionary in Central Africa and work with him for a year. Get some of that culture, get some of that mindset changed, and see why are missionaries just turning around and leaving right away. And really, it opens a brand new door. It opens a brand new world. And so now, with a year of experience for both me and Emily, we can now step into Congo with a mind of, okay, we kind of know what we're going to face. We know the differences. We're not going to offend people because we just didn't know how they are and how they act. And so that was the biggest blessing. So thank you.
All right. Boy, that's good, isn't it? And I appreciate that. Listen carefully. We're going to give you a couple quick announcements. And remember the schedule. We are having RU Friday night here, 7 o'clock as usual. And we will have our soul winning and bus visitation on Saturday morning. Even though it's New Year's Eve, we will have that Saturday morning at 10 o'clock. No New Year's Eve get together here this year. But Sunday services, 9:30, 10:30, regular schedule Sunday morning. 5:30 Sunday night, just an hour earlier on Sunday evening. We will be revealing the theme Sunday night and giving you the calendar and other information and reviewing the year, all that good stuff. And we will be having some things to eat afterwards. So bring the food in like you normally do for New Year's Eve. There's a sign-up sheet for that downstairs, and plan to have a good time with us on Sunday evening. You'll enjoy that Sunday night. All right. Also, just a reminder again, if you haven't signed up yet for the Grove City School of the Bible, that'll be starting off. When's that going to start, Brother Morning? January 24th, all right? And so, by the way, I know teaching the Bible is one of their courses. And if you're involved in ministry at all, junior church, Sunday school, that's a course you ought to take. That would help you. And I would want to get in on that. And the one is a Christian home, I think, is another one being offered, and to help you understand just what a Christian home's all about. And it just good courses this time, really is. So don't miss out on that. If you need more information, you see Brother Moreland, Brother Yoder, they'll help you out and get yourself set up for Grove City School of the Bible. All right, and I think that's all I need right now. All right, let's take a minute. We'll welcome any guests with us tonight. Anybody here tonight for the very first time? Just my man back here, my radio listener, right? And good to have you tonight, brother. Thank you for being here. And I appreciate you coming. And how's the carpet look? Doing all right? Doing all right? All right. He's friends with the fellow who laid the carpet in the auditorium here. So, it's great to have you tonight, my friend. Thank you for being here. The usher's going to give you a card to fill out in just a moment. And if you'll take just a minute and fill that out, appreciate you doing that. And then when we have the offering tonight, just drop that card in the offering, if you would. Keep the pen as our gift to you for coming tonight. We're glad you're here. All right, let's give this gentleman a warm welcome, shall we? Five thirty-eight. Blessed be the name of the Lord. All praise to him who reigns above in majesty supreme. 5:38. Once you have it, let's stand together to sing, all right?
All praise to him who reigns above, majesty supreme, who gave his son for man to die, that he might man redeem. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. His name above all names shall stand. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
We're going to greet each other, but listen, there's sickness going around, all right? So if you don't feel real well or you think you might be have something, don't shake hands, all right? Just give them a Baptist wave. Or give them an elbow bump, but, you know, keep your germs to yourself, all right? There's enough of that going around. And with that in mind, you greet each other. We'll come back and do the last stanza.
Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. His name shall be the Counselor, the Mighty Prince of Peace. Let's sing that last together. His name shall be the Counselor, the Mighty Prince of Peace. Of all earth's kingdoms conqueror, his reign shall never cease. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord.
All right, you can be seated, and ushers will come to get our offering this evening, and we're going to take the offering tonight and give it to John and Emily, and to be a blessing to them. And they'll be hitting the road for deputation here now for about a year. Is that about right? And trying to get some additional support. And then they'll leave, is it January of 2018? And you're going to go to France for language. Is that right? Language school. Okay. And so you got a year ahead of them. On the road, on deputation, with a baby. And it's a blessing, but it changes things, and so it changes the dynamics of it all, and it's great. Appreciate them being here tonight, and we're going to have the offering, and then they'll come and sing for us, and then Brother John will bring a message for us tonight from the Word of God. All right, let's pray, shall we? Father, thank you for the privilege it's ours to give. Thank you for John and Emily, and Lord, for what we saw that you have done in them and through them in these first 9 months of this last year, and their first 9 months on the field. And Lord, I'm praying that you'll continue to have your hand upon their lives. Lord, make this year of deputation very profitable. Touch the hearts of pastors and churches to partner with them. And Lord, I pray you'll continue to give them a fruitful deputation and prepare them in a great way, Lord, for the work you'd want them to do in the Congo. Lord, bless our giving tonight. May we be a blessing to them. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
So we're going to sing a song that we actually sang here last time, and just to let you know, but I enjoy this song, and we don't hear it when we're out of the U.S. usually, so it's a special song.
God sent his son, they called him Jesus. Savior lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. And then one day I'll cross that river, I'll fight life's fight, no war with pain. And then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the lights of glory, and I'll know he lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives.
Thank you, babe. And it's so true, too. A lot of stories come to mind. You know, I think of one of the men, Patrick. You saw him in the pictures walking towards the Omo church there, but just his back there. He's one of the main men in our church. But when he was a child, he was about 3 or 4 years old. His father abandoned him. It was a situation many times in Uganda where before a lady is of age to be married, the man who's interested in her wants to know if she can have kids. Because if she can't have kids, she's worthless there. And so many times they'll even have a baby before anything's done for the marriage, just to make sure the man knows she can have children. But what ends up happening is if that man decides not to marry her anyway, her village won't take the child, because who's the daddy? You know, he's not from our village. And I was telling you just earlier, everything is about that village life. Everything is about your family. And so if we don't know who your family is, if we don't know who your daddy is, you can get out of our village. You're not wanted here. And so that was the case with Patrick. The father ended up deciding, no, I don't want him. And so he left. The mother's left with the child. Well, she couldn't keep him. She didn't have the money, and she didn't have the land, which usually goes to the sons and not the daughters. So she got rid of him. And so he went from family to family to family to family, trying to find a place to live. Everybody would kick him out. And for years and years and years, he ended up being a homeless boy and putting himself through school. And I don't know if you realize just how hard that is. Many of the parents in Uganda, especially where we lived, can't put their kids through school. They don't make money. At the most, a lot of them in the villages will only make maybe $20 a year. And that's just through growing enough crops to sell. And that's over and above what they need for their families. And also many men will have 3 or 4 wives with tons of kids that they have to put through school. And so usually it's impossible for all the kids to go to school. Well, he not only raised himself, but he also put himself through school. And when he was a little older, finally his mother's village took him in and gave him a place to live, but would still have nothing to do with him. He raised himself. But he eventually got saved, eventually had some standing in his mother's village. Eventually he was able to get a piece of property from him, and is now one of the main men in our church. But he is another story of a man that, how could all that come about, and how could he have an outlook on life of happiness? Well, it's because he lives. And really, that's what it comes down to. He lives. And that's why we can all have an outlook of joy, because we know, look, this isn't all there is to life right here. And we die, we hit the grave, and we're finished. There's more coming in the future, and we can actually look forward to something in the future. So I love that song, one of my favorite songs. and we don't hear it outside the U.S., so I enjoy singing it here. So turn with me real quick to 2 Kings chapter 17. 2 Kings chapter 17. And I'll go ahead and turn this lapel on here. I'm not yet sure how I'll preach because I'm used to Uganda, and this is my first time to preach here. And so we do our messages completely different. We speak completely different. Everything's a whole new world. So this is my first time, so you're a test case for me again. Getting back behind an American pulpit with a bunch of Americans in front of me. But 2 Kings chapter 17, one of the special things about the message tonight is it's something that I really struggle with in Uganda. And I've really struggled with it for quite a few years now. It's something that I discussed with quite a few pastors and quite a few evangelists while we were on deputation. Just really trying to get my mind around it, not to the point of neglecting other things, but just to try to get my heart behind it. And I really hope I can present it to you tonight and you can truly see scripturally what I'm going to try to present here. Let's look in 2 Kings 17, verse 24. Let's start there, and we'll read through some verses, and then we'll pray. It says, "And the king of Assyria brought men from Babylon, and from Kathah, and from Ava, and from Hamath, and from Sepharvaim, and placed them in the cities of Samaria instead of the children of Israel, and they possessed Samaria and dwelt in the cities thereof. And so it was at the beginning of their dwelling there that they feared not the Lord. Therefore the Lord sent lions among them, which slew some of them. Wherefore they spake to the king of Assyria, saying, The nations which thou hast removed and placed in the cities of Samaria know not the manner of the God of the land. Therefore he hath sent lions among them, and behold, they slay them, because they know not the manner of the God of the land. Then the king of Assyria commanded, saying, Carry thither one of the priests whom ye brought from thence, and let them go and dwell there. And let him teach them the manner of the God of the land. Then one of the priests, whom they had carried away from Samaria, came and dwelt in Bethel, and taught them how they should fear the Lord. Howbeit, every nation made gods of their own, and put them in the houses of the high places which the Samaritans had made, every nation in their cities wherein they dwelt." Let's pray real quick, and then we'll move on. Dear Lord, I do thank you for bringing us here. Lord, I thank you for being back in a church that, Lord, helped raise my wife and helped make her what she is today so that we can literally travel and live in Africa and be a work there for you. But Lord, I pray that as we center around your word tonight, that you'll give me a clear mind, give all of us a clear mind, and help us to be able to truly take home something from this message. I pray that, again, you'll just help me as I seek to speak, settle my nerves, and help me to get my words out right. In Jesus' name, amen. So 2 Kings chapter 17. I want to ask just a few questions, and then we're going to move on, and we'll come back to this passage. Some of the questions may not seem to really line up with this passage, but just bear with me, and it'll come together in the end, hopefully. But the first question, and I want you to take maybe just a little bit of time in your mind and just answer this question in your mind, but come to one answer. Why did God save you? Just come to one answer in your mind. That's all I want. Why did God save you? Second question. Why do you seek to win others to Christ? So why did God save you? But then why do you turn around and seek to win others? What's the purpose? Last question. What is the purpose of your life? And I think maybe this last question will open up kind of the answer. But what is the purpose of your life? Why are you here? Why did God save you? Why do you seek to win others to Christ? So, as an answer to that, let's turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 10 to a verse we could all, probably most of us, could quote by memory. And if not, you probably can after tonight. 1 Corinthians chapter number 10. some of us, this verse probably popped in our heads. So I want us to read it, and then we're going to think about it for a second. 1 Corinthians chapter number 10, verse 31. Whether therefore ye eat or drink or whatsoever ye do, do all to the glory of God. Now let's read the next couple of verses. Give none offense, neither to the Jews, nor to the Gentiles, nor to the church of God, even as I please all men in all things, not seeking mine own profit, but the profit of many. Why? That they may be saved. Paul has just finished a chapter, really the end of the chapter, speaking about food and idols. And it comes up several times throughout Paul's epistles because it was a big topic at the time for a lot of churches. Food offered to idols, we've lived our whole life. Our generations and generations before have lived all their lives sacrificing these idols. And many times the food sacrificed to it was the food that was good to eat. We loved eating it. We would get it in the restaurants. We would get it in the temples. This is the food we would buy and eat. Now we're saved. Now we're Christians. Can we still eat of this meat, or should we refrain? And so he goes through this chapter again, speaking to the most carnal church, you might say, in the whole Bible that's mentioned. And he just lists it out here. But then he ends it with this. He says, look, if you're going to give offense, just don't eat it. Just don't eat it. It's not worth offending somebody, and especially their spiritual life, from coming to God. But he ends it with, whether therefore ye eat or drink, or whatsoever ye do, do all to the glory of God. So I'm going to ask these three questions again, and then we're going to keep on going. Why did God save you? Why do you seek to win others to Christ? And what is the purpose of your life? So let's turn back to 2 Kings. Again, this may not seem to go together, but you're going to see it pretty quickly, I hope. I want us to look at what I believe to be one of the first true missionary accounts in Scripture, you might say. One who was sent to a different land, to a foreign people, to teach about God. And I want us to kind of look at the method he used, how he came across, and see, does it line up with Scripture? 2 Kings 17, and let's start in verse number 1. We're going to run through a lot of verses real quickly here. In the 12th year of Ahaz, king of Judah, began Hoshea the son of Elah to reign in Samaria. Second verse. And he did that which was evil in the sight of the Lord. Third verse. Against him came up Shalmaneser, king of Assyria, and Hoshea became his servant. Next verse. And the king of Assyria found conspiracy in Hoshea. Jump to verse 5. Then the king of Assyria, when he had found conspiracy in Hoshea, then came the king of Assyria, came up throughout all the land, and went up to Samaria and besieged it 3 years. In the 9th year of Hoshea, the king of Assyria took Samaria and carried away Israel away into Assyria. Next verse. For so it was that the children of Israel had sinned against the Lord their God. And again, we're going to jump a lot of verses here. Verse 8. And walked in the statutes of the heathen. Verse 9. And the children of Israel did secretly those things which were not right against the Lord their God. Verse 10. And they set them up images in groves in every high hill and under every green tree. And there they burnt incense in all the high places, as did the heathen. Verse 12. For they served idols, whereof the Lord had said unto them, ye shall not do this thing. Yet the Lord testified against Israel and against Judah by all the prophets. Verse 14. Notwithstanding, they would not hear, but hardened their necks. Verse 15. And they rejected his, God's, statutes and his covenant. Verse 16. And they left all the commandments of the Lord their God. Verse 17. And they caused their sons and their daughters to pass through the fire. And then verse 18. Therefore, the Lord was very angry with Israel and removed them out of his sight. There was none left but the tribe of Judah only. And we come to this point and we say, but Judah's left. That remnant has been left. But then look at the next verse. And also Judah kept not commandments, the commandments of the Lord their God, but walked in the statutes of Israel, which they made, and the Lord rejected all the seed of Israel. Now, while we were in Uganda, every Sunday night, I taught through a series chronologically through the Scripture, mainly through the Old Testament, because I wasn't able to go all the way through it. But we started back with Genesis and walked through, showing God's face throughout the Scriptures and how He showed Christ coming and showed Christ coming and showed Christ coming. But one of the things we studied was when God made His promise, His covenant, to the people of Israel. And we can look at Mount Sinai, and He promised them, hey, I'll be your God. You'll be my people. I'll protect you. No one will mess with you as long as you serve me. As long as you serve me. And back at Mount Sinai, they, of course, raised their hands. Yes, all that God said, we'll do that. We'll just do exactly that. But even within the month, they were already starting to fail. They were already starting to fail. And they never, ever truly kept what God had told them to do. Well, God kept His promise in this passage here, as later on He told them, now look, when you serve me, I'll be your God and I'll protect you. But when you reject me, I'm going to allow those nations around you to come in and be your masters. And so this is what's happened here. We first find Israel turns from God. And not only do they partially turn from God, they literally reject Him and turn completely to the idols of the people that had used to live in the land. We find Judah's left, and Judah itself turns from God. That one tribe that was left rejects God and turns to the idols. And so that brings us to verse 24 again. So the king of Assyria comes in, removes all of Israel from their land, and replaces them with people from other tribes, other nations. And this is very common. And can I say, and we'll discuss it a little more in just a second, but it was also very common what the Jews did. It was very common also. Many times when these people would move into a foreign land, whether a king had forced them to move there or not, many times when a foreign tribe or a foreign nation moved into a new land, they sought to seek out who's the God of this land. We need to recognize this God of the land. And can I say, this is still very, very strong in Africa. I mean, extremely strong. You'll find someone who moves into a new village, a new area, and they seek to find who is, for lack of better terminology, the demon of this village, the family. Who is their ancestral spirit? And they do homage, they do worship, they will come in humbly to that spirit because they now live in somebody else's land. It was very common in this day. The Jews did exactly what all the heathen did. You move into a land, you may not accept their idols completely, but you at least do homage to those idols for your own protection. So what we find here is the king of Assyria has come in. He's removed the Jews from their land now so that they have nothing to fight for because their land is missing, their people are scattered, and he's moved foreigners into their land. But we find here in verse number 25 that as soon as the people began to dwell in the Jews' land, as soon as these foreigners were moved in, what happens? Therefore, because they did not fear the Lord, therefore the Lord sent lions among them, which slew some of them. And it came to the point that they were scared to even live there. And even if you look into it a little bit, it seems like they have even left the land because the lions were killing people there. And so they come to the king. We look in verse number 26. They bring the issue before the king. And what does the king say? The nations which, verse number 27, then the king of Assyria commanded, saying, carry thither one of the priests whom you brought from thence, and let them go and dwell there, and let him teach them the manner of the God of the land. So what is the issue we have? We have foreigners in a new land. They don't know the God of this land. One of the biggest things a lot of conquerors, even in old days, and can I say even to this day in some areas, is instead of removing all the people, he would leave some, especially some of the spiritual ones, to teach the new people, look, this is how we do things here. You don't want to offend the God of this area. But the king of Assyria had failed in this area. He had taken all the priests out. And so now the people were left with no knowledge of how do we worship the new God? How do we pay homage to this God of this land? And so he says, take one of the priests, send him back, and let him teach the people how the manner of this new God is. And so this is a question for you. We read through all of this. The priest comes. He teaches the people about the manner of the God of this land. But then we come to verse 29 again. Howbeit, it's the very next verse. Howbeit, every nation made gods of their own and put them in the houses of the high places which the Samaritans had built. After being tortured by lions, after being killed by lions, and after having left, and the king says, no, send them a priest, let them go and dwell there. Let all the people live there. The priest teaches them the way of the God of the land. But then we find every single nation begins to build their own idols. What happened? Why didn't these people just turn from their idols and say, well, this is the God of the land. This missionary's come. This priest has come. This preacher's come to teach us how to serve this God. Why didn't they just leave their gods and come to this one? I want to bring up an issue that I've battled with a lot. And can I say I battle with it a lot in Uganda? And I had a lot of discussions with several missionaries over there about it. And all of them had the same worry, and all of them had a different idea. But I want to present scripturally an issue with this. Let's first look in verse 27. Then the king of Assyria commanded, saying, carry thither one of the priests whom ye brought from thence, and let them go and dwell there, and let him teach them the manner of the God of the land. First question, is anything wrong with what the king has said here? Is anything biblically or morally wrong with the king saying, send a priest to help those people out? Nothing's wrong with that. He did something that any ruler would do. Look, we have an issue. I have the fix. Send that priest over there and teach him about the God of the land. That's all that's needed. Next verse. Then one of the priests, whom they had carried away from Samaria, came and dwelt in Bethel and taught them how they should fear the Lord. And can I say, is this not what a missionary does? We go and we teach how to fear the Lord. You're living on his land. This is the God of the land. This is how we fear the God of the land. But then something goes wrong. Because in the next verse, they truly didn't fear the God of the land. What was the break here? What had caused the issue? Because take this for example. If you were to support us, we're going to Congo. We go there and we spend years there preaching, teaching, working among the people. We come back, and then you go and visit, and there's not one work left to be seen. Everybody's worshiping their gods, just like they always did. You would begin to wonder, what has this guy done for these years? You know, he spent maybe 15 years here. What has he done? Where's all the work that he accomplished? Is there not one man, is there not one lady that has turned her heart to God to serve God? So when I was discussing with this with several people, they automatically came up with the response of, look, these people made their choice. A man of God was sent. He preached to them. He taught them about God. And they just made a choice. They rejected God. That was a choice of their own. But can I say that's not the whole issue here? And I believe we can see it pretty quickly because I'm going to ask a couple questions that will bring it out. But let's read on. Verse 30. And the men of Babylon made Succoth Benoth their own god. And the men of Cuth made Nergal their own god. And the men of Hamath made Ashima. And verse 31 is the same. All these nations making their own god. Verse 32. So they feared the Lord and made unto themselves of the lowest of them priests of the high places, which sacrificed for them in the houses of the high places. They feared the Lord and served their own gods. What is the issue here? What has gone wrong? So let me ask a couple questions that I hope will bring it out, and I hope you'll see it. These people come to the king. What did they ask? They said, look, we're being killed. Something needs done here. What happens? The king says, I know the answer. I'm sending a priest to teach you. So the first question, did the people really want to serve God? Was that really their focus? We want to serve the God of this land. Or was their focus, we don't want to be killed? Now think of that with me. What was the focus of these people? King, we want to know the God of this land. We want to serve this God. We'll reject all other gods. We want to serve this one true God of the land. Or was it king? We're being killed by lions because we don't know the method, the way of this God. We need to know the way of this God so we aren't being killed. So that's the first thought I want to present to you tonight. All right? Think that with me. But then, what did the king do in response? Or here's a man of God, go teach them about God. What's the purpose again? So they won't be killed by lions. This is the purpose. Now get with me with this, because I pray I can bring it around to our lives here in a fairly strong manner. Everything was focused on these people have a problem, a physical problem that man of God can fix, because he can teach them the manner of this God of this land. You're getting with me here. Okay, so the man of God goes in verse 28. Let me go back. Then one of the priests, whom they had carried away from Samaria, came and dwelt in Bethel and taught them how they should fear the Lord. Question, why did the man of God truly go to this place, to this mission field, to this new area? Was it to bring God, the one true God, to the people? Or was he being sent, and why did he go? To keep these people from being bitten and killed by the lions. Now, the man of God may have had a pure mind in this, but to the king and to the people, there was only one purpose for God, and that was to solve our problem. We have a problem, and we want this God to solve our problem for us. And I think that flows into the answer here. So we have verse 28, the priest comes, he teaches the people about this one true God, the God of the land. In the next verse, in the very next verse, howbeit every nation made gods of their own, because God had fixed their problem. We learn to fear this new God, we learn to serve this new God, but we don't give up our own gods, because this God just solved that problem in our life. But all these other gods solve these problems in our life. Now, let me put this in an African mindset. In the villages, every family, which is usually what's made up of a village, every family has a spirit. And for many years, I don't know how many of y'all were able to keep up with updates, but for many, many, many years, at every funeral, the spirits of these families, the spirits of what we might think of as ancestors, but the spirit of the family would show up at these funerals, and the village would feed the spirit. They would pay homage to the spirit. The spirit was everything to them. It protected them. It gave them prosperity. It allowed their fields to grow. Everything was about the spirit or these spirits that protected their village. Put that in this mindset right here. They weren't going to give up their gods. You'll see it all over Africa, especially in our area, so strongly. These people go to the Anglican church. They go to the Catholic church. They go to the Baptist church. But when they go home, they still have their spirits that they pay homage to, and their village still holds just as strongly as it ever did to the spirits of their village. Why? Because if you break the spirits, ruin will come to your village. Is God the answer for a problem, or is he the whole answer for everything? I think that's the answer we have to get to tonight. Why did God save you? Well, because he'll keep me out of hell. He'll take me to heaven. I'll be a better person. I'll have victory over this. I'll have victory over that. Or did God save you? Because when Paul said, do all to the glory of God, it's because God says, no. I'm saving you because I deserve you. I deserve your glory. I wish I could present this in a better way, but I hope it's getting into our minds. Why did this mission, you look at it, a heathen king. We have this even nowadays where you have these heathen rulers that'll say, missionaries, you come. If you'll give a Bible to all our children in school, you can come and preach. You can come into our country, whatever you want to do. And it's a heathen king doing that. And we say, praise the Lord, look at what's going on. But we have to be careful at the same time. Are we being brought in as a missionary, or maybe as a preacher in a church, or maybe as somebody, just a family member who somebody knows you're saved and they want to counsel with you, and all they want from you is, teach me a little bit more about your God, because you claim that God will solve my problems. I think this carries over into a lot of things. But to me, this is the biggest point right here. Turn to 2 Timothy. 2 Timothy. I have heard this passage preached so many times I can't count. But it took a Ugandan pastor to kind of open it up a little beyond my thoughts, because he helped prove this point in my mind right here. And by the way, 2 Kings 17, that passage, I was actually searching for a passage that could be a good missions passage. This man of God went, he saw people saved, he preached the word, and his whole focus was to teach you the God of this land. Well, that's missions right there. We're here to teach you about the God of this world, who you need to know. You need to be saved. But then it turned around and I started seeing all the issues, and I started saying, no, something's not right, because not one person is ever recorded as truly just turning to God. They have all their other idols plus God. 2 Timothy chapter number 3. The end times. We like to say even nowadays, and believe me, I believe we are, we're in the last days. But read this passage with me real quickly and notice with me something. Verse number 1. This know also, that in the last days perilous times shall come, for men shall be lovers of their own selves. Jump with me to verse number 4. Traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God. Where are we as Christians today? We throw around the word humanism so much nowadays that I'm afraid we don't see it even in our own life. So when it all boils down to this, who is God to you? Is he a solver of your problems? Or is he the one that deserves every single bit of your life and more? We looked in 2 Kings where the people have a problem. They're heathen people. They already have their own gods. And can I say, maybe it's a little clearer in my mind because I saw it in Africa so strongly. They already have all their own gods. They don't need another god. But then all of a sudden, here's a problem. Or they have a recurring problem often, and they hear that this other god will solve their problem. And so what do? Well, we need another god in our lives. Let's add another God to our life, and he will solve that problem in our life. But they've never given up all their other gods. But even in the Christian realm, you and me who are saved, we look at God and we say, God, look at all that I've done for you. Don't I deserve such and such? Why don't you do such and such? Do I really belong in this state of my body physically, or do I really, my family, look at all they're going through? We get the mindset that, God, you're here to solve my problems. Where are you? And we forget that, no, God's not there to solve our problems. He's there to be God. We're here for one purpose, to lift him up, to glorify him. And that's why, when it all comes down to it, you can say, all things work together for good. Why? Because in the end, he gets lifted up. He gets lifted up in our lives. He gets lifted up in our homes. He gets lifted up in our churches. Why? Because everything is not about the individual believer. Everything is about him. He's the focus. He's the center. Why can a missionary be sent by a heathen king to these people? Everybody's looking forward to this person. Everybody's looking forward to the missionary. Everybody's looking forward to the preacher. He comes and he teaches them about God, and they turn and they begin serving God too. But then, the very next verse, not one person serving them. In fact, a few verses later, they feared the Lord and served their own gods, because God solved their problem. But he wasn't their God. He was just the solver of their problem. Let's turn back one more time, and I want us to see the outcome of this. 2 Kings again. 2 Kings chapter 17. What is the final outcome of this? Can I say, when you present Christ to somebody, you have set a precedent in their lives. If you present Christ as, look, Christ will take you out of hell, Christ will take you to heaven, He'll take care of your addictions, He'll take care of all the issues you have in life, this is what God will do for you. Well, then we create a weak Christian who's always expecting God to do the next thing for them. And when He doesn't do that next thing for them, well, there's the other church down the road that's promising more. If I'll just do what they say I need to do. Because we've created a Christian that all they can do is just do exactly this and this and this and this, and God will just do this and this and this and this for you. God doesn't exist for us. We exist for God. So what is the outcome of this? And can I say, I haven't preached it in a way that may be completely understood, but keep on studying this passage, and I think more and more will begin to come out. But what's the end result? Let's look in verse 33 again. They feared the Lord and served their other gods. Now that's the past. That's the past. They feared the Lord and served their own gods after the manner of the nations whom they carried away from thence. Next verse. Unto this day they do after the former manners. They fear not the Lord, neither do they after their statutes, after their ordinances, or after the law and commandments which the Lord commanded the children of Jacob. What's the end result? Well, God solved my problems now, so now I don't have the problem anymore. Why do I need another God? So now we come to the place we don't even fear the Lord anymore. The end times, whatever you want to call it, the last days. Who are those involved in all that? The lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God. Men shall be lovers of themselves. I believe it's both the Christian and the heathen. I believe it's both the saved and the unsaved. Because so many times you look around nowadays, and what is every Christian about? God, what can you do for me? God, I need you to fix this problem in my life. Now, I got saved, just like you said. And I've been doing this, just like you told me. And I've been doing that, just like the preacher said I needed to do. But this problem is still in my life. Why isn't it being fixed? In Uganda, one of the issues we had was years ago, the missionary that had originally come and founded the mission for immoral reasons was kicked out of the country. The church blew to pieces. And literally, the remnants were just very few in number. The missionary that took over that I went to work with has spent 3 years just trying to pull just basic pieces back together from a ministry that has just blown to smithereens. And one of the things he brought out, and we've seen several people saved that have been coming to this church for even like 14 years. But one of the things he said was, God was always presented as the solver of their problems. They would come, the ministry provided their health care, the ministry provided their education, the ministry provided food for their children in the orphanage, even though the children were orphans. The ministry provided all their needs as long as they would just come to the church and serve God. He said, now, God's not there to solve all their problems. They don't need that God anymore because their spirits protect the village. Their spirits give rain. Their spirits do whatever they need them to do as long as they pay the spirits enough. They don't need that God anymore. But we do the very same thing here in the U.S. We have a mindset of, God, you're here for me. And as long as you can just keep on taking care of my needs and keep on taking care of my problems in my life, then I will just serve you as best as I can. We don't realize that, no, God's not there for you. You're there for God. And He not only deserves your life, He deserves everything you have and more. Because that's why you're here. That's the whole purpose. 2 Kings chapter 17. We look at missionaries. We have expectations of missionaries. Can I say we should, to an extent? A missionary is there to do God's work. But at the same time, how is it being done? But can I bring it home? We go out soul winning. how often do we present to people, look, salvation is for you. Christ will save you. He will take care of all your problems. He will take you to heaven when you die. All these things God will do for you if you'll just accept Him. But we fail to present to them, but everything you are, everything you have, is God's. And everything about your life is not about you. It's about serving God with it. It's about glorifying God with it. So many times, we'll even look at the last days and, oh yeah, men will be pleasure, you know, they'll love themselves and they'll seek the pleasures of the world instead of pleasures of God, but we don't realize that we do the same thing. In fact, we're addicted by it. What's the next thing we can have? How can I better my life, and how can I better the lives of around me, those around me, instead of saying, God, how can we better you? How can we glorify your name? How can we lift you up? We think opposite. So let's maybe consider it. Read through the passage again. It's easy to find. It's 2 Kings chapter 17. Look at a missionary that was sent, and look at literally just the utter failure. Initially, they served God, had their own gods. Then next, they had a fear of the Lord, but served their own gods. And then the very next passage to this day, they don't fear the Lord, they don't keep His statutes, they don't do anything He commanded to be done. Why? Because He solved their problem. Because that's how He was presented to them. Is God here for you, or are you here for God? What's the purpose of your life? Let's pray real quick. Dear Lord, I do thank you for the day. Lord, you know how strongly I wanted to present this and how, Lord, how much I wanted to get it across. Lord, we live in the last days. It's not a secret thing to us. It's not something that we question, Lord. I believe each and every one of us know, look, the time is coming. You've got to return soon because it's just... the world is the way it is. But Lord, sometimes I'm afraid we just don't realize that we're as much a part of those last days as anybody else. And Lord, when we present you to people as He is the solver of your problems, Lord, the only way they know you then is you're the solver of their problems. And they don't realize, no, He is the God of the universe. And you're here for Him. You're here to do His bidding. But even in our own lives, Lord, I'm afraid sometimes we in America get so relaxed. There's no persecution, Lord. We're free to spread the gospel anywhere we want. And we get to the place where we're so relaxed that our life ends up being spent on how can I better my own life and those around me? How can I be a good person? And we forget, no, our whole life is just to lift you up, is just to glorify you. Everything we do, whether we eat, whether we drink, whatever we do, is just to bring glory to you. I pray we'll be soul winners. Lord, each and every one of us, not just the missionary on the field, but each and every one of us here at home, if we're saved, we have a calling. And Lord, I pray that we'll take it seriously. But at the same time, Lord, we'll keep our lives in check and we'll realize, Lord, you are our God. And we just want to serve you with our lives. Whatever you may tell us to do, whatever you may give us to do, we'll just do it. Pray you'll help us tonight to think on these things. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's go ahead and stand together, shall we please? And bow your heads just for a moment. Just want to ask you before we close in prayer, and we have our dismissal tonight. I wonder how many, that was an excellent message. I wonder how many of you would say, Lord spoke to my heart tonight. Oftentimes we all can slip into that, God's just my problem solver instead of my God. And my focus gets to be what's He doing for me instead of what am I giving to Him and what am I doing for the Lord? I wonder if how many folks tonight just say, "Preacher, the Lord sure did speak to my heart tonight. Pray for me this evening, would you?" Slip your hand up. Yeah, that's what I thought. Amen. That's great. That's great. Father, thank you so much for the message this evening. Thank you, Lord, for the power of your word. Thank you for the good presentation of your word tonight through Brother John. Lord, I pray that you'll help each of us to keep the focus on how great you are. And Lord, our responsibility and our desire is that no matter what we do, we would bring glory to you. We would put you in a good light. That others, no matter what we do, they would see our good works and glorify our Father, which is in heaven. Lord, we pray that we'll live our lives that way. Here as we close out this year and as we look into a brand new year that's yet to come. Father, thank you again for Brother John and Emily and for what you're doing in their lives, Lord. Thankful that we get to have a part in that. We love you. We pray you'll dismiss us now with your care, Lord. Watch over us as we go our separate ways. And, Lord, I pray that each of us would be mindful of your presence with us and help us to do those things that are pleasing in your sight. And I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I'm pressing on the upward way. New heights I'm gaining every day. Higher ground. Let's sing that together, shall we? We'll have John and Emily, why don't you go to the back here? When folks leave, they can shake your hand. Would you do that for us, please? All right, ready? I'm pressing on the upward way. New heights I'm gaining every day. Still praying as I'm onward bound. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand on heaven's tableland, a higher plane than I have found, higher ground. Now, just before you leave,